Hello and welcome. Today, I have a very distinguished guest with me, the former Chief Justice of Delhi High Court, Sri Rajinder Sachar. He was the man who headed the committee that studied the social, economic and educational status of the Indian Muslims and the report which was popularly known as the Sachar Committee Report. He is now in his 90s and he is very willing to answer our questions. Sir, most welcome to my program, and I am very glad and happy to see you here.
Same here. Okay.
So, my first question, it's been almost 10 years since your report has been published. How do you view the present situation of the Indian Muslims? Does it have any improvement when after the BJP government came to power, or does it remain the same as was in 2006?
I won't distinguish between the present and the previous government because this is too small a period. And but there were many, one of our very important recommendations was that we wanted, you see, first is that our report, first it is only said, one criticism is, why was the report concerning Muslims? Why not the others? Now that is a misunderstanding.
So that was just in terms of reference of the Prime Minister's office?
No. Terms of reference were that we have to give a report on the various aspects, economic, political, poverty,
social and education,
vis-a-vis the other communities also. So that when we said that there is, say, 4% employment in a particular sector of Muslim, we also said how much was the employment of caste Hindu, scheduled caste, scheduled tribes. It was a comparative table that you gave.
But you were particular when you said that the conditions of the Muslims are more backward than the OBCs.
That is true, whatever we have said, that is why. No? Otherwise, if we were only to give, say, that Muslims are, let us say, 5% in the employment, that will only give one side of the thing. But when you have to give within it that OBCs or Christians or Jains, they have comparatively more thing than according to their population. That was the brief.
Do you still feel that the Muslim community in India is having a very particular discrimination by the government?
You know, one of our recommendation was that in the states where in certain pockets Muslims are a substantial number. So in order to give them confidence, because whenever communal tension happens, so if they don't have the protection of security and others, it is more troubling. So what we said was that where there are fairly large number of Muslims in any particular locality, you should have a police inspector of a thana who should be a Muslim. Now it was not this that only Muslim will look after the Muslim, or he will go against the Hindus, or a Hindu cannot be a good inspector and give them equal treatment. Psychologically, every person has a feeling. But for example, in this Muzaffarnagar that took place in UP recently, we had sent a team, the PUCL and the Socialist Party, to investigate. We found it very horrible conditions, and I wrote also to the Chief Minister saying that one of the big defects that we found is that there is no Muslim inspector or police.
Does it mean that the situation, the condition of the Indian Muslims still remains the same?
You see, that figure is not coming up to date because no other committee has appointed, but one of our big recommendations was that annually the Government of India must publish reports of each department segregated. Okay. For example, say in class 1, how many are Hindus, how many are Muslims, and others. Because getting figures is not communal. Getting to know figures, this is a very wrong approach to say, why should the government find out how many percentage of Hindus or Muslims are in education or in class 1, anywhere where there is a composite population.
I still remember, sir, that an interview I have read those days when you published your report.
Yes.
You said that you have got assurance from your higher officials that the government of India, then the UPA government, will in letter and spirit will do your report, I mean all your recommendations will be done. Do you feel that the government kept their promise on this?
I can't say that, because one of our very big recommendations was the Equal Opportunity Commission.
Yeah. So that was one of the significant.
Very significant. You see, the reason is this, that if supposing, for example, there is a big complaint these days, and prima facie, you can't deny it, that's the housing discrimination. Mm-hmm. Or the reports have even appeared that some of these corporations go in making a decision about employing from the community's anger. Same application sent in the name of Muslim will not find favor, and the same application sent in the name of Hindu finds it. These are instances which have been given by some of the researchers, and it has not been denied. So therefore, now in this say private sector, a Muslim has or any person discriminated against, say even Dalit, or even a Hindu for that matter if it is otherwise, has no remedy. He can't go to court of law.
What is the reason that you find for these governments not giving proper attention on these things?
I don't know. Previous government had 2 terms which had appointed us.
So it was the same government that appointed you?
That same government, because we were appointed in 2006. I gave my report in 2007.
Was that an eyewash by the government of UPA?
We had said very strongly that this Equal Opportunity Commission is a must, because you see this is not only in India, it exists in America, it exists in England.
At the time when your report was tabled in the Lok Sabha, I think it was in
2006, in November.
It was in November 30, 2006, I suppose. At that time there was so much of attack from the opposition. And I still remember there was a seminar conducted by the Bharatiya Vichar Manch. They said this is not fair, and this report should not be allowed. This is against the Indian secularism. And I think those persons who believe in that ideology is now ruling this country, the BJP government. Mm. Do you think that they will be fair to the Muslims? I mean to the minorities based on your recommendations?
You see, this is where the public opinion will come. I mean, you see, these are government policies. They, of course, will be, I feel, not as pro as it is the previous government was. Though we are dissatisfied with their working also, but how it will, we'll have to monitor them.
Now, when you compare UPA with NDA, who is more sincere?
You see, UPA this is the first year, and there are certain schemes which are going on. And there's a reduction in the funds which are to be allocated for the schemes which are meant primarily for Muslim areas
by this government.
And
what about this National Minority Development and Finance Corporation? Like,
It was, they worked wrongly. One of our recommendations was, frankly, and this we emphasize, the previous government did not also much follow, was wanting to.
But that will be the test
is that we had said that instead of just determining that this much percentage, they have a 14-point program, which means you set aside at that time 14%, now probably more.
But then Finance Minister P. Chidambaram took some strong actions on that.
Yes.
For that National Minority Development and Finance Corporation.
Chidambaram
had a very fair approach on that.
National Development, they have to see it. No, what we suggested was, what happens is we said you go to the taluk level to spend that money. Because one of the recommendations is that where Muslims are in a substantial number, the funds should be spent there so that they get the maximum benefit being less developed. Mm-hmm. It's like this, you see, supposing in a district where there may be 15 or 20% Muslim. Mm-hmm. If you choose that district to disperse funds, so far as Muslims are concerned, who are more, developed, they'll get 15-20%. Mm-hmm. But if you find a district where they are 70 or 80%, then the benefit of it will obviously go to a larger number. So that's what we had suggested, and that also, unfortunately, the previous government did not really follow.
So what you are pointing out criticism. Is, what you are pointing out is, when compared to the UPA government,
that
the NDA government has cut down.
It has to, cut, they I have mean, cut I down. Think for that, naturally, some other study will have to be done. We haven't done one study.
But
ours is not a continuing study. So
it's okay, but what I understand from your words is that the NDA government has cut down the fund to for the welfare of the minorities, especially Muslims.
If they
compared to the UPA.
Oh, well, then certainly there will be less benefit to the Muslims. If they, because the funds already allocated were not sufficient, were not substantial enough. We wanted more funds to be allocated. But if those funds are being cut, then with increasing population, I mean, they are obviously inadequate and will not serve the purpose.
I'm sure, sir, you will be aware of this latest developments, controversies and debate that is going on around about this growing intolerance in India. Mm-hmm. But the BJP has always taken a stand that these are all created by the media, these are all things that have taken out of proportion and has blown up by the media. Mm-hmm. Do you see that the government stand is right, or does it have an atmosphere of intolerance in India, in our country?
No, it is. I mean, if you ask me, it is the government, present government's response to these things, which is making things worse. Because if the Home Minister in the Parliament says that secularism is not part of the constitution,
that was what Rajnath
said, or that it was included later on. Now the fact is that the Supreme Court has said secularism is a basic feature of the constitution.
Exactly.
I mean, probably Mr. Rajnath Singh, I don't know whether he's done law. There's a difference.
Yeah.
Fundamental rights are defined.
They were talking about
right of free speech, right of others. Supreme Court earlier, in 73, in Keshwanand's case, had said these rights, which are called fundamental rights, some of them can be changed, some cannot be changed.
Mm-hmm.
But basic feature is one which cannot be amended.
Which means secularism, which socialism?
Secularism and socialism, they cannot be amended. And it is also wrong to say that socialism as such was not mentioned at the time of constitution. You see, at the time of constitution, K.T. Shah asked Dr. Ambedkar that why are you not putting socialism as such? So Dr. Ambedkar said, by directive principle which I have included, if that is not socialism, what it is? These were his words. So it was clear. Similarly, in 83, Supreme Court has categorically said that though socialism is not mentioned, it was implied in it. Now, it's a different matter. Nobody can deny, frankly. I can't even deny that putting word secularism and socialism was the to try to wash out the emergency thing by Indira Gandhi.
Then what will be the motive and intention of this government for saying all these things? Like Rajnath Singh said, there is no such word called secularism. So equal rights, equal justice to all religion should be done. But so not the word secularism.
But this is what secularism is.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
This and is why. I mean, when for example, this 3 days, 4 days back, I read Bhagwat's RS statement that we should build a very strong Ayodhya temple. This is downright treason. To me, it is treason.
Yeah.
I mean, first you have done such a thing, and they suffered for it. If you remember, post Ayodhya demolition, there were 9 states in which BJP had the government. We went to the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court in judgment in 74 dismissed that, dismissed the state government. There's a provision in the constitution that if the constitution is not being carried out in accordance with the constitution, then the central government can dismiss the state governments. So the central government at that time, fortunately, was not BJP. So central government dismissed them. BJP governments went to the Supreme Court saying, we have done nothing wrong, why are you dismissing us? And 9 judges held unanimously that secularism is the basic feature of constitution. And therefore, anybody who violates this basic feature, that government cannot be allowed to continue. and this power was exercised.
So let me ask you one more thing. That what you are telling is, though there is secularism, socialism, everything imprinted in the constitution, it is not practically done in both letter and it is there in the letters, but not in the spirit.
It is not being followed. Just as, for example, the word socialism is not being followed right from the previous government also.
Yeah, it's okay.
We are giving more power to this industry. Mm. And to give you an instance, which is a carryover from the previous government of this special economic zone.
Mm. What about secularism?
Secularism in that sense, I mean, one can't deny, because of the diabolical philosophy of the which the Jan Sangh and RS follows, they're worse. They're worse. At least they openly now advocate an anti-Muslim feeling. For example, they dare say that we will build a temple when the Supreme Court is still to decide about the matter.
Yeah, exactly.
So to the extent that they have, and how ridiculously, you know, or how treasonably this one MP or even Haryana Chief Minister can say that if Muslims don't like this, let them go out of India. I would say they are daring. This is treason to say. I mean, this is not the India is not the personal property of RSS or BJP. They can say, you know, Hindu can live or Islam people cannot live or Christianity cannot live.
Sir, about these recent incidents, like the murder of Akhla Khan for storing beef in his house, then Dalits being murdered, and Shah Rukh Khan, Amir Khan's there.
And Mir Khapur.
Yeah, everything. So do you feel that this country has become a place where these minorities can't stay here with...
I believe there are there's overwhelming number of population including Hindus who are totally dead against this RS ideology.
Yeah, exactly.
Simply because they happen to be Hindus doesn't mean that they are RSS. If that was so, they should have been in the central government.
But all the power is with them.
They should have been in the central government long time back.
But the power is with them, with the BJP, with the RSS.
Yes. Though it is true that BJP is now in power, therefore in the center they are now in power. And overwhelming power. And therefore all these people with the bad motives are saying all this thing. But I would like to tell everyone that the soundness of the heart of country, including Hindus, is not for it. Therefore, this, by the way, remark of Amir Khan, Shah Rukh Khan, by saying, which they are entitled to, simply because they are Muslim, they should say that it's an intolerant condition. Why? If they are intolerant conditions, as they are, if writers feel that this is something which we can't accept and therefore we are returning the words, who are they obliged to keep it? Their conscience is not. For example, I was offered a Padma Award by the previous government. Mm-hmm. I refused to take it. I refused. Not because I was against the government, though I am, but not for that reason,
so
but for others.
You support all these. You support Amir Khan's statement. You support writers giving back their awards. You support all these movements.
Certainly. And I think to catch on to just by the word of Amir Khan to say that I feel like that he's only emphasizing enormity of intolerance that is in this country. I mean, these people are icons. Shah Rukh and they are icons for India.
Yeah, yeah.
And anybody who starts doubting their loyalty to the country and daring to tell them that if you don't like it, get out, I'd say, who the hell are you? You get out. Simply because he's a Hindu, he thinks this country belongs to him. This country doesn't belong to Hindus.
Let me repeat one of my questions, sir. Do you still say that the basic soul of the constitution, like secularism, are facing new challenges under this government? Do you say that?
There's no question of safe. They can't do anything to it. I mean, apart from public protest and demonstration, we could probably even invoke the Supreme Court also that this government can't continue.
There are occasions when you see that these are, they stand by the constitutional stuff. And in practicality, they do the reverse. No, so we have so many issues like that.
No, no. You see, there's a difference. Basic feature is one which the constitution makers believe and you can't touch it.
Yeah, that is fine.
Now, fundamental right, for example, originally it was said that if you take property of somebody, state takes property of somebody's, you will have to pay him compensation. And compensation meant full market value. This was the original view of the Supreme Court. Then later on, there was an amendment of the constitution which said it doesn't mean market value, it means fair compensation. Those proprietors went to the Supreme Court and Supreme Court has upheld this amendment. Because fundamental right and basic features, there are difference. Fundamental right may, basic features also fundamental right in that sense.
So even when I agree,
for example, to give you an instance, all these governments are still continuing with the word sedition. It is unconstitutional.
Exactly.
I mean, it is a thing which our founding fathers and mothers did not approve of.
Even when I agree with all what you said, I still personally feel that one of my questions remain unanswered.
What?
And that question is,
yes.
You talked about these constitutional rights and all, and you said that it should be maintained by the government, otherwise the Supreme Court will intervene. All that matter, all that part, I agree. But for the government, there are innumerable ways of doing, you know, injustice to be very, you know, partial to the minorities.
Exactly.
There are so many ways. And
you are right.
That.
For example, they use this word beef, etc.
Yeah, exactly.
Beef, dadri. I would frankly want some of these NGOs, because the information that is, I read in one of the research paper is that India, the beef trade is about $3.2 billion, which means about $30,000.
Yeah.
Both export, both media. Let me make it clear, the word beef does not include cow's meat.
Exactly.
Supreme Court has banned that. It is only the buffalo's meat and others. Out of that, either in export or in control, 95% it is the Hindus, even non-Muslims. 95% of the trade, including export, is with non-Muslims.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
They are the figures. So let the government come out with, and frankly, I don't know why some of the NGOs do not ask for right to information. Export, you have to have a license. For setting up a company, you have to have a license.
Yeah.
Therefore, this information is available. And to say that you should not eat beef, who has given this right to any government or any individual? If that is so, I would say after 14 crore Muslims, don't eat pork then. If you can't let people eat beef, what the Supreme Court said is a law, we can't help it. But what these journalists say, that is none of their business.
Okay, let me ask you another thing. What is your opinion about the Indian legal structure system? My question is just because Markandeya Kadju, in one of his very controversial remarks, he said most of the, a section of the judges are corrupt. A section of the judges of the Supreme Court are corrupt.
Are corrupt. I don't, frankly, these are all said so by him. I mean, for me to say.
you might have heard that.
No, because if I was a party to such, and knowing it, I would be able to see it. I mean, and it is bad enough, frankly. I mean,
you don't see it unfair to have such public remarks.
Well, no, he continues that is so. But that the perception is there, I can't deny.
Right. So, coming back to the issues of minorities again, what will be the kind of recommendations or what will be the kind of perspective to improve the life of the Indian Muslim under BJP rule? What should be the kind of approach the government should take?
You see, this will, one simple answer is that they are entitled to all the rights which our constitution gives. Preference to the non-Muslims is downright violating the constitution.
As a person who has administered justice to several, as an Indian, how will you evaluate our Prime Minister Narendra Modi and his policies.
In what way you mean? How horrible his thinking is different to magistrate, because his policies in either way are not acceptable to me. His corporate friendliness is something I, as a socialist, can't support.
And one final question to you, sir. How strong and firm is your faith in our secularism? Will always our India remain home for all sections?
No doubt of it. Secularism cannot be taken away. Average man is not anti-secular. These people will all their showing only because they are in power. Only because in their power, so naturally they create an atmosphere. And some, since you are asking me, I can ask put a counter question.
Yeah.
The media behaves a little more conservatively and controlled than it should. My advice to everyone else, to my colleagues, and also so goes to the media.
Yeah.
I am expecting a more democratic, open criticism without favoritism.
Let's hope for the best. Thank you very much. It's my honor and pleasure talking to you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.